American troops killed as the battle for Iraq spreads from city to city. A gunman murders a Sydney solicitor. And two AFL players at the centre of a new drug scandal. Good morning. It's been nearly a year since we were told the war in Iraq was over. But today it appears anything but, with increasingly violent and deadly clashes at several locations across the country. The worst bloodshed has been in the city of Ramadi, where as many as 12 US Marines have been killed during a clash with militants. An American defense official says a significant number of Iraqis have also died. The fighting came as US forces stepped up operations against rebels in nearby Fallujah.
The operation is dangerous and progress has been measured, with small teams of soldiers moving from home to home. As promised, authorities are delivering retribution for last week's gruesome attack on American security guards. But as expected, the fighting has been fierce and deadly.
The city is isolated. A number of people have resisted and been killed. It will be a methodical effort to find the individuals who were involved.
While the lockdown continues in Fallujah, a more troublesome situation continues in the south. Radical Shiite cleric al-Sadr has released a statement warning resistance will continue until occupying troops withdraw from populated areas. And there are reports loyalists have taken over government and religious buildings in the holy city of Najaf, where al-Sadr is in hiding. The US says it will need to be patient.
We obviously have, as I said, groups of people who do not share the vision of a democratic Iraq where power comes from the ballot box. They believe it comes through the barrel of a gun.
White House sources say British Prime Minister Tony Blair will travel to Washington next week to meet with the president. On the table, the US government's plans to send even more reinforcements into Iraq to handle a potentially volatile confrontation. In the United States, Karl Stefanovic, National 9 News.
The hunt is on for a gunman after the murder of a Sydney solicitor at his home in the inner western suburb of Petersham overnight. Police are also searching for a motive to the brutal killing.
Homicide squad detectives were back at the crime scene this morning, interviewing neighbours and searching for more clues into the murder of 42-year-old Tom Williams. The Sydney solicitor operated his practice in an office adjoining his home in the suburb of Petersham, but shortly before 9:30 last night, while he worked, Mr. Williams was shot dead at close range. Mr. Williams was found near the door of his office by his wife after she heard a number of shots fired. Suffering bullet wounds, Mr. Williams died despite efforts of ambulance paramedics to revive him. Forensic police worked throughout the night combing the area for clues, and this morning a possible breakthrough with an appeal.
We've received information about a man who's described as about 5'6", 5'7", of stocky build, ran with an athletic style about himself, wearing a dark beanie, dark jumper and possibly dark or grey trousers.
As news of the murder spread, neighbours were in shock.
Just a dreadful thing happened in the street, I can't believe it.
A manhunt is now underway for the killer of Mr. Williams. Daniel Street, National 9 News.
Over the weekend, it was the NRL, now it's the AFL, embroiled in a drugs controversy. Two Carlton players are on the verge of being sacked after allegedly arriving at a team training session under the influence of illegal drugs.
At a time when Carlton should be on a high in the wake of a rare win at the weekend, the club has instead reverted to crisis mode. After assembling the team leaders for an impromptu powwow training, Blues boss Ian Collins then headed to an emergency board meeting to discuss the futures of Lawrence Angwin and Carl Norman. Not that Collins was giving too much away following the two-hour talks.
It's a combination of a lot of issues that have been going on over a period of time.
Angwin and Norman are said to have turned up to Carlton's recovery session on Monday in an unacceptable state. Reports this morning suggest the club instigated drug testing for the pair. According to the Age newspaper, Angwin tested positive to ecstasy.
The AFL, still embarrassed by the recent allegations of sexual assault involving two St Kilda players, are closely monitoring the Carlton situation and ready to step in if needed.
there are provisions in the AFL rules for the pair to be sanctioned.
Well, there's a range of things available to the Carlton Football Club, and I'm not trying to preempt what may happen in this case, I haven't got all the information, but they can be subject to the code of conduct. It could be monetary sanctions, it could be suspensions, but that's up to the Carlton Football Club. And
Carlton won't train again until tomorrow, by which stage the club will have decided whether there's two empty lockers. Tony Jones, National 9 News.
An elderly woman in Melbourne has had a terrifying experience during a home invasion overnight. The 80-year-old suffered a heart attack after trying to hold on to the would-be thief until police arrived.
Muriel Hill was sitting in the kitchen of her North Melbourne home when the intruder broke in through her front window. The great-grandmother suffering a heart attack when she discovered the young woman searching her bedroom at 7:30 last night. Mrs. Hill managed to call her son before she collapsed.
And certainly she made it clear on the phone that, you know, she was pretty darn annoyed and was doing her best to make sure this girl didn't run away.
Neighbours say Muriel grabbed the intruder and tried to hold her until police arrived. But the frail 80-year-old was no match for the young woman, who broke free and fled. Mrs. Hill has lived in this house for 45 years. Her many friends on Wales Street distraught at the intrusion.
It's really, really upsetting to hear that, you know, her husband passed away and she's going to stay on her own, and then they do this.
You hear about it and you don't think it's going to happen in an area like this. You know, just shocked.
One neighbour saw the burglar as she was walking her dog, but thought she was visiting the elderly lady.
As I looked at her, she was coming down the steps, and she saw me because we had sort of eye contact.
While police continue to search for the intruder, Mrs. Hill remains in a serious condition. Michelle Fraser, National 9 News.
An 11-year-old girl is recovering in hospital after being attacked by a crocodile in far north Queensland. Hannah Thompson was swimming with friends at Margaret Bay near the tip of Cape York when the croc grabbed her arm. She was saved by the quick actions of a man who leapt into the water from a nearby boat and gouged the crocodile's eyes. The schoolgirl suffered deep puncture wounds to her arm but was otherwise unhurt. The Prime Minister will announce a $335 million package later this morning aimed at helping troubled children and young families. It's tipped to include funding for more childcare services, an education scheme for parents, and a program aimed at preventing child abuse. To business news, and home buyers have been given an Easter reprieve this morning after the Reserve Bank left interest rates unchanged. Finance reporter Oriel Morrison joins us with the details.
Thanks, Layla. Well, the central bank has left interest rates on hold at 5.25%. As usual, it's given no reason for the decision of no change, but it's believed the slowing property market, lower consumer spending, and the upcoming election all had an impact. Economists are forecasting at least one rate rise by the end of the year. Elsewhere, Rupert Murdoch's decision to move the headquarters of News Corporation to New York is not expected to have a significant impact on Australians, with no major job losses expected. The move comes as the media giant hopes to attract more US investment in the company. It will have its primary share market listing in New York, but will keep its Australian one as well.
They're analysts and they, you know, follow our stock, and they thought it was very good. It was quite unanimous.
Telstra is set to make another large acquisition, only several weeks after buying the Trading Post business. Shareholders will vote on the decision to buy the technology services firm CAS Group in late June, the deal worth $333 million. On the markets this morning, the All Ords ahead 7 points. The ASX 200 is up 4. Gold is high, trading at just over $419 an ounce. On the currency front, the US dollar has softened. The pound is now at 1.84. Our dollar is stronger. It's buying just over 76 US cents. And that's morning's finance news. Layla.
Thanks, Oriel. Well, the Beckhams are used to very little privacy, but even they must be surprised at the hungry media pack swarming outside their chalet in the French Alps. It comes as the life of the alleged other woman is turned inside out by the tabloids, including claims she's bisexual.
The Beckham family were reunited inside this French chalet for the night, but after the week's revelations, somewhat under siege from the media. But as Britain's most photographed showbiz couple, they know what to do in these situations, call in the reinforcements. First to arrive, two private ski instructors. No public ski school for the little Beckhams. then the local gendarmerie and a private security guard to deal with the over-eager cameras.
We want cooperation, we want to get the job done.
Other holidaymakers looked on in fascination at the circus on their street. All of Victoria's family are here, including the youngest Romeo. But David and Victoria got into their car behind closed doors and were whisked away in a convoy of blackened windows. Yesterday, the Beckhams weren't so coy, snapped playing in the snow. Photographs that created the desired headlines and an image of a couple facing their difficulties together.
As for the other woman in all of this, Rebecca Lewes, she can't be finding her time in the spotlight very comfortable at all.
And today she had to face yet more revelations about her private life in the newspapers. As for Beckham, he has to rejoin his teammates in Madrid, but he seems to have weathered this storm, and even his mother-in-law doesn't appear too angry.
Coming up in the morning news, Australian surgeons call for all drivers to be retested after the age of 70. And the fleeing bank robber who survived to tell the tale. A suspended police officer is reportedly under investigation for allegedly supplying the murder weapon used to kill one of Melbourne's gangland victims. And crime figure Carl Williams has told the Bulletin magazine he isn't afraid of becoming the next victim. He says, unlike Lewis Moran, who was gunned down last week in a Melbourne club, he won't run away if anyone tries to kill him. He says the underworld boss should have charged his attackers rather than trying to escape. Police have identified Williams as the next likely victim of the gangland war. In Spain, a would-be bank robber is recovering in hospital after surviving an horrific motorbike accident. The 25-year-old, claiming to be armed with a grenade and a pistol, terrorized hostages for 12 hours before eventually swapping them for a getaway bike. But his escape was brought to a dramatic end by an unmarked police car. Despite completing two somersaults before slamming into the road, the thief survived with a few broken bones. Police are said to be in no mood for lenience following the Madrid train bombings. And being three times over the legal limit was probably the reason a drunk driver in England didn't notice she was travelling down a motorway the wrong way. 50-year-old Sandra White, a police worker, played a dangerous game of chicken for more than 20 kilometres before she was stopped by the highway patrol. She's now serving a three-month jail sentence. And it's that very issue of drink driving along with our national road toll that's prompted Australia's leading surgeons to enter the debate over licence checks. They want all drivers over the age of 70 to be tested twice yearly and tougher conditions for learner and P-platers. To tell us more, we cross to Associate Professor Peter Dan. Good morning, Professor.
Good morning, Layla.
Well, drivers in New South Wales aren't tested until they're 85 and there's no set age in Victoria. What's wrong with that?
Well, that's far too long, an interval for testing. We're recommending that every second year people over the age of 70 should have a test of their level of impairment. It's more level of impairment than age that we're focusing on, actually, because younger people who have disabilities may also fall into this category.
Now, yep. What about learner and P-plate drivers?
We think it's very important that people are prepared for driving better than they are now, and that we're recommending 120 hours of preparation on the road before someone can take their P plates.
And what are you hoping that all of these recommendations will end up achieving on our roads?
Layla, what we're hoping for is a further reduction in mortality and morbidity, that's injury from road trauma. Road trauma and trauma generally is still the greatest cause of death and disability in our community under the age of 40 years. And as our community ages, we're going to find that that becomes a much more important and frequent cause of death and disability in the older age groups too, who of course are more susceptible to trauma.
Professor, we'll leave it there. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Layla. Yeah.
She's delivered a speech in French and walked the streets of Paris, and now it seems the Queen is managing the impossible, breaking down the traditional rivalry between the British and their neighbours across the English Channel.
It was business as usual, a bunch of flowers, a wave and a smile. On the streets of Paris, though, a battle royal had broken out as the crowds jockeyed for a picture of their new heroine. A stroll through an old Parisian quarter quickly proved what a popular hit this state visit has become. From the florist, a bouquet of sweet peas. Jean-Francois Dayon told me that he thought the pastel colours perfectly suited the Queen.
I like English people, really. I like the Queen. I love the Queen. your Queen.
At the National Riding Centre, a display of French equestrian style and precision. From the masters of chic, there have been plenty of compliments on the Queen's classic, elegant appearance. A few walkabouts have brought dramatic results. French newspapers even daring to suggest it's time to stop sneering at the British.
Sport after the break, including the comeback Kings celebrating their second NBL title. And young Adam Scott on his chances at the Masters. The comeback Kings are the talk of the basketball world this morning after clinching back-to-back NBL titles in Sydney last night. The Kings won the championship decider 90-79, despite the West Sydney Razorbacks leading by 17 points in the third quarter.
Almost a full house for the decider, and as Sydney spluttered through the first quarter shooting 4 from 17, the visitors took over. Two steals within 30 seconds put West Sydney on top 28-13.
Razorbacks have scored the last nine.
Sam McKinnon's three kept the Razorbacks 15 in front. Contained to just 3 points in the first half, star guard John Riley reloaded for the Razorbacks. After McKinnon's dunk extended West Sydney's break to 17, time seemed the only thing on Sydney's side before the shooting percentages suddenly increased. After leading by 7 with 3 minutes to go, the Razorbacks rubbernecked it as Ebi Arar led the Kings' last hurrah. His 14 points in 10 minutes put Sydney on top 82-79. And Brian Gorgon's go-get-em command,
"You gotta be strong with the ball, right now, Wheeler!"
pumped up an amazing 18-0 run. A 90-79 victory extended the Kings' reign on the league, the fifth team to win back-to-back titles. After losing 5 previous grand final deciders,
Brett Wheeler gets a ring.
Best feeling in the world, best day of my life. It's the sweetest thing I know, buddy.
Charles Christian, National 9 News.
At the AFL Tribunal, Essendon's Matthew Lloyd has been outed for 2 matches after being found guilty of striking. Lloyd argued he tried to raise his arms to get above Nick Dal Santo's front-on tackle, but the tribunal ruled he made forcible contact underneath the St Kilda player's jaw. Geelong's Brent Maloney has also been suspended for 2 games for striking Carlton's David Clarke. But better news for Port Adelaide's Michael Wilson, cleared of rough play. And in rugby league, Manly's John Hopewate will miss a month of football to work on his fitness. The veteran utility player broke his leg last year, and after talks with coach Des Hasler, it was decided Hopewate should concentrate on regaining his strength and speed. Manly says the decision has nothing to do with his sin binning during the Sea Eagles' loss to the New Zealand Warriors last Sunday. 7 Australian golfers are in Augusta, Georgia, preparing for the US Masters, which starts Friday morning. Among them, Adam Scott, who struck winning form at the prestigious Players' Championship just 10 days ago. Now he's aiming to reproduce that performance to become the first Australian to win the coveted green jacket.
Patience is the key here this week. It's getting very firm and fast, and you'll hit a lot of good shots this week that may not get the results they deserve, but you'll have to grit and bear it and try and get it up and down or save par, and just got to keep yourself in the golf tournament for 3 days, and then Sunday you never know.
And Peter Lonard is impressed with the Augusta setup, some of which reminds him of Melbourne's famous stretch of golf courses.
It's going to be an interesting golf course. Those greens are unbelievably fast. So, it's similar in ways to, the Sandbelt, if it stays the way it is.
Still to come in the morning news, the latest weather details. And ABBA celebrates a special milestone. Now for a look at the national weather, and a high over the Bight is bringing mostly stable conditions to the southern states. Around the country, Sydney, just the chance of a shower in 21. Canberra, fine and 22. Melbourne, sunny and 19. Adelaide, fine and 24 degrees. Perth, sunny and 30. And Brisbane, a few showers and 27 degrees. And there's been a reunion of sorts for Swedish music legends ABBA at a special performance of Mamma Mia in London. It's exactly 30 years since the legendary band won the Eurovision Song Contest with the song Waterloo, which put them on the road to success.
There are other people who should really be with us here tonight.
They should actually be up here now.
Yeah.
And that missing person was former group member Blonde Agnetha, who's been a virtual recluse since her divorce from Bjorn more than 20 years ago. And that's the morning news for this Wednesday. Our next major bulletin is at 6 p.m. I'm Leila McKinnon. Hope you can join us at the same time tomorrow.